finance department. Today I'll be presenting on the developing country debt and macroeconomic stabilization controversy. As Tessa said, sorry, my partner couldn't make it, and I hope my voice isn't too boring by the end. The aims of the presentation are to have a clear definition of understanding of the key concepts surrounding the topic, to understand why developing countries are prone to debt, to know why developing country debt is such a big issue in the global economy, to understand what measures can be taken to reduce debt and to link the theory to real-world examples. We'll start off with some basic definitions of the terms that we're using throughout the presentation. So we've got the debt, which we should have known, but reduce your obligation to pay money, deliver money or regular goods under an express or implied agreement. External debt, debt owed by a country to foreign creditors, as opposed to internal debt. Debt to the borrower, creditor, the lender. And then odious debt, which is debt accumulated from loans that do not serve the best interests of the nation. So an example of this would be debts accumulated by South Africa during the apartheid regime. The loans didn't go to the best use of the nation, but outside of the apartheid regime, when the Nationalist Party was no longer in power, those debts still remain with the country. So here's a really basic map looking at a straight divide of developed and developing countries. With a definition for a developing country, a country with a lower GDP per capita, which is less developed in terms of industry, has a smaller capital stock and overall poorer living conditions. A couple of limitations of the, first of all, the image we've got. So, for example, China, despite being a great producer and you know, a great global economy, some of its living conditions could be considered poorer. So that doesn't come into account with definition. And also, the term developing country implies that we're going through an improvement of living living conditions, or the country is in fact developing, when this isn't always the case. In some cases, the countries are actually regressing. Why do developing countries accumulate debt? So we'll start with constant borrowing throughout history. In the 19th century, when America was a developing country, it had to borrow a lot of money. The same for Australia, and it's continued with developing countries. Countries like Argentina have had a similar problem. A current account deficit, balance of payment issues, which we'll be looking later. Intertemporal trade, which is something we've looked at in class. The idea that you import more in one term, and you hope to pay for those imports with exports in a later term, or the other way around, which can accumulate debt if those exports don't come into fruition. Developing countries want to invest in capital, but they don't necessarily have the savings of developed countries. So developed countries see an opportunity to invest in developing countries. And if these investments are unprofitable, then of course we have an area where debt can be created. Poor government policies and financial institutions, so the idea of lower saving rates, government policies that reduce savings, so it's not the money in the economy to invest, and poor financial institutions. We have this idea of capital flight, maybe because of lower interest rates or just better banking elsewhere, where people can move their money, often in developed countries. Colonialism, so the idea that some developing countries were part of a colony, and the debt of the, I think the term is the colonialist, has left upon that country, as well as taking some of the resources. So, for example, Mexico lost a lot of its silver to the Spanish, the Congo diamonds, South Africa lost lots of gold, and odious debt, which I've touched upon with the Okay, balance of payments. We can break it down into a current account, a capital account, and a cash account. The current account deals with imports and exports. Obviously, imports are needed to exports improve the current account. Unilateral transfers and foreign investment, and short-term transactions, which is implied from the term current. Capital accounts, the inflows of capital and outflows of capital. So I touched upon the idea of capital flight, where capital moves out of a country, which is, we'll look at it later, but is, it contributes to the 1980s debt crisis, because a lot of Mexico's debt was accumulated through through capital flight. And the cash account, guys, the cash account is the idea that we balance out the balance of payments by the end of it. So if we have for example, more imports than exports in the current account, we don't have the investment, then it's down to the cash account to make up the rest of this deficit, and we'll look at why that could be bad for developing countries in a second. Balance of payment issues, okay, so yeah, this is what I was saying. If there's a deficit, the current account and capital account, the country has to pay for it using its cash reserves from its cash account. Of course, in developing countries, there's less gold, less cash reserves, so this can be a problem. Obviously, they can combat this by improving their current account, but the key issue here is that if a developing country loses its cash reserves, as we looked at in our last assignment, the cash reserves are quite often in developing countries responsible for creating a peg in the exchange rate. So if the developing country doesn't have this cash balance, then countries aren't going to be able to peg their exchange rate, which could see a depreciation in their currency against the hard currencies, which is more often than not what their debt is owed, so it sort of enhances the debt. Okay, so this is what we're talking about, improving the current account, improving the capital account, and improving the cash account. But also in 1970, the IMF created something called a special drawing right for developing countries with a depleting cash account. It can't just give countries gold because the world doesn't have that much gold. It can't just give them hard currency. So the idea of a special drawing right is that they get this. It's also called paper gold, which has a value of currencies, which can help their cash accounts so they don't see problems of depegging exchange rates and things like this. Another place that developing countries can go is to the IMF and the World Bank for loans. In order to receive help from the IMF, there's conditionalities which come in the form of a stabilization policy. We'll look at an example of this later. And for the World Bank, it comes in the idea of structural adjustment. So these loans, unlike loans of commercial banks, which don't come with any conditionality or requirement, the IMF and World Bank have particular requirements. Okay, so typical IMF conditionalities are removal of foreign exchange and import controls, devaluation of exchange rate, anti-inflation program, so raising interest rates, government spending cuts, wage controls, and open economy to promote foreign investment. We'll see in a minute how these can be detrimental to developing countries. So here are the criticisms of the IMF stabilization policy. They're harsh on the lower income groups in developing countries, which does not promote development. I talked about removing tariffs on imports, which means that imports are more readily available, which will help developing countries accumulate capital. It will be detrimental to things like developing countries' farmers who have to compete with the global market if countries start bringing food and things like that. A lot of these developing countries' industry is based on agriculture. Lower inflation, which helps the balance of payments, but does not promote development necessarily. Another criticism is that the USA is in huge debt, but does not have to abide by the conditionalities that developing countries do. Down to preserve the global market, helping institutions and governments of developed countries. So these developing countries that have come under the IMF maybe feel that the IMF's aim is to help the developing countries to repay debts to developing countries rather than actually helping their development. And outdated improvements have failed. An example of this is between 1982 and 1988, the IMF practiced some of these policies on in Latin America in 28 countries. And although there were some loan repayments, there was also a lower quality of life and higher levels of unemployment, stagnation, and faulty growth. The World Bank, similar to the IMF, in terms that it has its structural adjustment, it was originally also criticised for making things worse for the poorer population, but recently, as of the 1990s, it aimed to help poverty and has revised the target to end extreme poverty by 2030 and boosting shared prosperity for the bottom 40% in developing countries. So it sort of answered the criticisms that were maybe throwing at it in earlier days. Okay, looking at the 1980s debt crisis. So why was there a debt crisis in the 1980s? As I said, there were a lot of problems in Latin America around the 1980s. A lot of this was caused because in the build-up to the 1980s, in the 1970s, there were huge growth rates in Latin America. And in order to maintain these growth rates, Latin America saw that it was best to keep borrowing and keep importing. And because of the nature of the imports, they had a trade deficit. These countries were more likely to borrow from commercial banks, which might have higher interest rates, as opposed to borrowing from the World Bank or the IMF, because they didn't want to go through this structural adjustment. They were experiencing great growth, they wanted to keep this going. The idea of capital flight, which I talked about earlier, was responsible for 62% of Argentina's debt growth and 71% of Mexico's. Capital flight often comes around from speculation. If lots of debt is accumulated, then people are worried that the country might default, so it's likely to move its capital elsewhere. Another cause of this could be taxation. Just going back, guys, that's something I missed out. Another cause of the debt crisis could be down to we had sort of an oil boom in the 70s before it crashed in 1979. So a lot of countries, particularly oil producers, were looking to maximise the use of their oil through the accumulation of capital, loaning, so they could bring in lots more things to help them get the best out of the oil. And also, Middle Eastern countries were saving a lot of the profits from their oil in commercial banks, which is why commercial banks were so ready to lend. In 1979, we had an oil crash, and in 1986, when oil prices went down, of course, this was detrimental to the economy and helped stimulate this 1980s crisis. Okay, just a quick look at Nigeria and Mexico. They're both oil-producing companies, which I've just been talking about. As you can see, Mexico's debt has grown quite significantly higher than Nigeria's debt. It also starts off higher, which could come from the idea of, that I've just been talking about, of high growth in Latin America, high borrowing, and then we see periods later on where we have stunted growth. For example, between 1985 and 1990, although we had a fall in oil prices, the IMF intervened at this point and helped to reduce the impact of the fall in oil. So we see sort of like this period of it's almost a plateau, it's still slightly increasing. So I talked about the huge growth in the 1970s to cause borrowing. The World Bank, as I said earlier, after the 1990s began to curb debt in Africa, which we can see from the decrease in Nigeria after 2000. And Mexico showed some improvements from 1996, where the line actually starts coming back down. But then we see a huge increase as of the recent crisis. Okay, finally, just looking at some other ways of reducing debt. The idea of restructuring debt, so you can change the conditions, maybe increase the length of time that a country has to repay it, or reducing the interest rate. The idea of a debt for equity swap, so a company can trade debt for shares in domestic companies at a discounted rate. Then the idea of a debt for nature swap, which is quite interesting, especially as we've had a presentation on the environment, which is basically where a company acts as like a medium. For example, the WWF might buy debt from America that Mexico owes it, and in return, Mexico will have to pay the